Okay, so I'm going to talk about internet memes, and while I do that, I hope that you'll be able to, you know, get some idea about something called clickjacking. You might have tried it on others. You might have been a victim of this, and I'll tell you, you know, how you can find that out. But it's going to be fun. We have a system where there's a 10-minute Q&A. So we can do that, but you can stop me in the middle, ask your question. For the camera, I'll be repeating the question, and then, you know, we can do that. We'll keep it interactive because as it is after lunch. So the topic of my talk is, I have your mouse keeps in keystrokes. What's the meme here? What? Yeah, actually. So lolcats is what they started calling them later, but it started with I can has cheeseburger. I actually forgot the can. And I don't know if you guys know this, but the company Hasgeek, when we were, you know, they were thinking about the name and all, what I had suggested was Hasgeek, like H-A-Z, but I don't know, there were some grammar Nazis or something. Okay, so, you know, let's get to what clickjacking is. User interface redress attack. UI redress attack, UI redressing. Okay, so those are some of the other names it's known, you know, it's known as. As you can see, they are pretty formal names, and a lot of research on web application security has been happening in universities. And the first time someone mentioned something that or like this could be a problem was in 1999. Okay, long before any of the dynamic, rich internet apps that you see now. And in 2008, there was a pretty popular cited paper by these guys called Arsenic and Jeremiah Grossman. They use the word clickjacking. And what it means is, clickjacking is when an attacker uses transparent or opaque layers to trick a user into clicking on a button or link on another page when they were intending to click on the top level page. Thus, the attacker is hijacking clicks and or keystrokes. Okay, if it's not clear, I'm going to repeat it just for clarity. Is when an attacker uses transparent or opaque layers to trick a user into clicking on a button or a link on another page when they were intending to click on the top level page. Thus, the attacker is hijacking links and or keystrokes. I hope you got that. So, I don't like that definition at all. So, which meme is this? No, that's what they call, but what's the name of that character? It's called the Angry Derp. Derp, D-E-R-P. I don't know why. Obviously, Angry Derp trolls a lot. And he goes like, why you know and whatever. So, I thought that was a nice one. Laughter. We should have a laughter track. Okay, so this is what I meant. And this is what that definition meant. What does this mean? This is what's visible, which is in the background. Okay? The attacker is going to attack this. This is transparent, but it is in the foreground. Which means the user, when they click or they type something, the input goes here. But for them, it's all happening here. This is what clickjacking is about. Okay, now there are many forms. It's pretty difficult to safeguard applications which work on iframes or cross-domain message passing. It's a difficult thing because understanding that it's going to happen, and it's a problem at the user end. This is happening in the browser. Because the user is, you know, maybe socially engineered into clicking something like on Facebook, you see this amazing message says, see what this girl, you know, what happened when this girl's father walked in. And you click on that. Yeah, exactly. That's what, you know what you did when your wall had that message? You were clickjacked. There are a bunch of others. Now, if you look at this, it is pretty simple. And what I'm going to talk about is, you know, what is happening with clickjacking and what are the different attacks that we have seen in the wild. Okay, I'm not covering all of them, but I'm covering the high profile ones. For you to get an idea, you might have read about it, you might have been a victim of this, but you may not know what happened, what really happened. And at the end, I'm going to talk about like how you can prevent this. If you're building applications, if you are, you know, you're a designer, you're thinking about UI, you are looking at like, you know, I want a kick-ass UI, but does it enable attacks like these more often than, you know, something which is less glamorous or something? So, which one is this? Oh, well done. We are in the philosophy room, by the way, in this college. This is the philosophy one room. So, how does one redress the user interface? Right, it's not that, you know, because Jace is a friend that I get to talk here on any topic. It's about UI. And why or how are you redressing the UI? So what's making it possible? So I don't know if you went to the funnel and if you read what I've written about the talk, I have mistakenly mentioned that this requires CSS3. Well, it doesn't. I've done more research. That was just to submit the talk. I've done the research and CSS2 has this property as well. So these are the main ingredients required which enable something like clickjacking to happen. Okay, the first is iframes. I think almost all of us use this. A web page can contain another web page within it. Okay, Google Maps is one of the most common options. We have, you know, locators, pages. Opacity, HTML elements can be solid, partially transparent, or invisible. Okay, so if I think most of you would be aware of this, but if you're not, this is what is happening. There is a stacking order. HTML elements can be stacked on top of each other. So you see where it's going, right? You make it invisible, you know, the opacity is set to a certain value, they're stacked. Stacking plus opacity, an element can be on top and invisible. So I don't know if you can see this image clearly. This is Google loaded in iframe. Okay, and here it's stacked on top of another window, but in this case it's invisible. So you can see what's happening behind. Okay, I want you to understand that even though I'm talking about clickjacking specifically, because that's one easy topic to address security using UI, user interfaces. This is a problem in other places also, like, you know, how does someone know that a web page is secure? A web page is HTTPS. The lock, which is a lot of people rely on, you know, before all this, the green and the orange bar and all that which has come now, people used to rely on a lock which is visible somewhere on the browser, right? When Chrome came out, they changed the position of the lock from anywhere else to the favicon. You know, the place where favicon comes. What? Yeah, in the tab. On the left of the address, the URL, which meant that if someone hijacked that page and they were able to replace the original favicon of the website and show the lock, some people would mistakenly believe that they're on a secure page when they were not, right? So even that is a UI redressing attack. So there are multiple classes of attacks in UI redressing. I'm just covering about clickjacking, right? I just want you to understand that. So, coming back to this, so if you have iframes, if you use opacity, stacking order, and stacking plus opacity, you can do something where the page which is behind, this is visible to the user, while your invisible page in front, you can, you know, inject or hijack clicks. Okay, so when you use Facebook and someone misuses the like button there, that's clickjacking because the like button is, you know, somewhere where you're clicking. Now there are different ways of doing this, and there's a concept of social engineering also. Someone has to actually take some action. This is not the kind of attack where the user doesn't do anything and then they get infected or something. So the user is to be blamed. They want to watch racy photos of, you know, some fantastic video or whatever. So they have clicked something, mistakenly or whatever, but they have.
Can you give an example of the
I will. I'll give you three examples. So, this is what will happen. Z-index, this is which is a property of CSS2, puts the iframe on top. The opacity makes the iframe invisible, and the position absolute lines up the iframe with the dummy page. Now, this is the important part, because the original web page is not in your control. So wherever the button on the original page is, it's going to be there. What you need to do is the attacker's page has to be aligned in a way that when something gets clicked, when the user is going to click somewhere else, you know, the actual button gets clicked. But there are ways around it. There are new advanced attacks on clickjacking as well. So there is a div with style with z index of 10, which makes this on top. The opacity is 0, and the position is absolute, starting top 0px. So, you know, from the viewport leftmost top, right? That's what it means. And this is the invisible frame on iframe on top. And there is a you know, social engineering thing saying claim your price. If you use Pirate Bay, one of the most common ads you'll see in Bangalore is you're the two people from Bangalore who have been selected for a prize. Click here. Seen that? Nobody? So, how to like anything on Facebook? This is my first example. This is from a demo page. If you click on view demo, now obviously this attack is not without user in, you know, doing something, user action. So when they do that, wherever the mouse cursor is, now you can't see the like button here, but the like button is under the mouse cursor. Now in this case, it doesn't matter where the button is or whatever, because Facebook has a particular API, I think it's called the Open Graph API or something, right? And you can like pages and share and all that, and based on what you like, you know, it'll get added to your profile or it'll come in your news feed, something like that. A well executed clickjacking attack would mean that it will ask your friends to also click on that link that you have just posted, which you're not, maybe not aware of. So if you take care of, you know, the like button being under the cursor, it could be like a game where you're like, it could be an easy game that shoot this face and you might win. Yeah. This is not the actual case study, but there have been around 4 to 5 different attacks on Facebook about this. It's called like jacking. So if you're Googling it, it's called like jacking. It's basically click jacking for the like button. There's another case study where in that case, they would show you a page which kind of looked like YouTube. The like button was the entire viewport. So it doesn't matter where you click. The idea was that, it would say that the video would start. It would show you some, you know, the first two frames. But then it says, please enable, or the audio is mute, click here to unmute. Right? Sometimes it would say click here to unmute, or click here to view the video in full screen, something like that. And the entire viewport was like button. So this is, in the slides that you get, these references are already there. So this will show you the exact code that the view demos, you know, this thing, so that the like button follows the mouse cursor. People good with JavaScript will be able to understand it. And the person who released this called it how to like anything on the internet. Apparently for some people, the internet is Facebook. So this is my first example. This is the big one. This was what was released in 2008. The Flash player in your browser has settings. I don't know if you've ever right clicked a Flash movie. You can reach these settings. And again, it's very small. Yeah, so there's a box and you can choose the Flash player to have access to your webcam and your microphone, right? So this attack was against that. That you see a game, and when you click, basically the flash settings for your browser have been loaded, and when you click on that, it gets allowed. So when this these guys wanted to present it at a conference in 2008, and Adobe made sure that it didn't. Adobe was like, this is a massive attack against privacy, so we have to, you know, take care. And so they didn't release it. But when they released it, this is how they released it. So Adobe thought that it was solved. I will tell you about the mitigation later, but Adobe for some time thought that it had been solved. But what they did not realize, that the SWF file, which is on the Adobe server, which can also be used sometimes, I don't know how, but can be used, and it can be iframed. You can either iframe source, you can put directly the path which is on the Adobe server. And if you set, you make some setting changes there, those are also persistent. Okay, so in 2011, someone revisited the attack and they were able to cause some damage. But the point is, what we are trying to see is, this will look like, do you allow AJAX or some question, and only the allow button is visible. The allow button is actually from the settings option of Flash.
What is that hack called?
What?
What is this hack called?
This is again clickjacking. So when you go to search for, just search for Flash Player clickjacking. You will get more references for this.
Yes.
Yes. So his question is like, some part of the page which is supposed to be visible, that's visible in this case. Yes. So again, the attack, you know, it can have different ways of making it work. But the point is, there are two pages again, right? And the actual click which you think you're making for this page will go to a different page which is being attacked. Okay, and that's the objective of the attacker.
This allow and
yes, in this case they usually have two iframes, an iframe with an iframe, right? So the original iframe is it's transparent, it's invisible, and the second iframe, it's only meant for that. It starts from that point where the button is visible, and that one is not invisible, right? So you can do that. How many did fell for this one? Honestly, come on. This happened last year. Nobody? It's called the Twitter don't click attack. For once, this was not by, you know, someone, some spammer. It was just someone who figured out Twitter was, susceptible to this attack. So they created a link, a tiny URL link, and they called it tinyurl.com/don't click. Okay. But it overloaded Twitter servers because it said don't click, which meant most people clicked it. And when they did, this got posted to their Twitter feed. Okay, if they clicked and they went to that page, this got posted. This is a window from NoScript. NoScript is an extension for Firefox. I'm not sure if it comes from other browsers. Maybe from Chrome, I don't know. So that when they realized, NoScript was initially meant to make sure that no JavaScript, which is not whitelisted by you, gets executed when a page loads. But they realized this attack can happen without any JavaScript being involved. This is just how the page is being aligned, right? Based on the layout. So they created this other thing called clear click warning. Okay, this additional technology called clear click, which will tell you exactly, it will basically make anything which is invisible visible, and it will tell you this is where the click is going. So this window would pop up. Now obviously in terms of usability, this is really, really horrible. But if you're worried about your reputation, you don't want people to realize that you click on things you're not supposed to click on, so that's something you can use. How many of you have seen this new Facebook thing where there are two images and there are like these two women sitting on a railing on next to a cliff, and it says don't click here at one point, and it's pointing to where, you know, Facebook shows you all the images in this modal window, right? With the left side and the right side, like an ebook reader, if you click anywhere, it goes to the previous image or the next image. So it's pointing to don't click here, and if you click there, the next image, that one of the women is falling. Nobody tried that? Okay, I tried it. So this is for people like me. The problem was, again, this is the network effect, and Twitter faced it more than Facebook, which is a little surprising. But that happened, that as soon as you click on this, this gets posted, don't click, and the URL. You click on the URL, you go to the page, and this gets posted on your, you know, like as your next tweet. And within, I think, a span of 8 hours, Twitter realized that they were facing outages, and you know that Twitter fail whale and all that was showing up. So then people got in touch with the people, I think the person behind TinyURL, to get the, you know, the link blocked for abuse, and then Twitter fixed this. And how it has been fixed for Twitter, for Facebook, for Gmail, that's another thing I'll show you a little later. Yeah.
I'm talking about that, let's say, suppose that don't click URL you're getting. So where does that script sit? Suppose you click on that, don't click.
On the page which this URL leads to.
Okay.
So it will go to a web page,
okay,
which is maintained by the attacker.
Right.
Right? On that, he has loaded whatever he has to show you, like a big don't click button. But behind that is the Twitter thing. Like behind, I'm saying, because it's in front but it's invisible.
So that Twitter API, with this click,
it doesn't have to be an API, right?
Okay.
It can be a normal post.
But we can't go against the user. Yes, the thing is that I don't know how
that is. As soon as the person clicks the don't click button, he's clicking the tweet button.
Okay.
Yes, because clickjacking is only about, purely about user action. User has to say, take some action. So what is being misused? What is the weakness? That the user can't see the invisible, you know, iframe which is loaded there, logged in session. Again, the person has to be logged into Twitter. It will not work otherwise.
And this happens. When did this happen? I don't know.
Yeah, I think this was last year. If I don't remember.
How?
By creating an iframe tag. That URL went to a page which was owned by the attacker. So again, they have that Zindex thing. They have exactly what this is. You see this? This is a page controlled by the attacker. Right? And they have a div with some, they've done the Zindex, opacity, absolute, and the iframe. So consider this is where the Twitter thing was. The attack is exactly the same. Got that? So, do you understand what's happening here? Make my eyes clean, right? So, this is what was visible. The don't click button was here, which this is what was visible. But the action of the click was happening on Twitter, which was loaded here. Already the message was set. Don't click this and the tiny URL link. And the tweet button was there. So the when the person clicked don't click, they were actually clicking on the tweet button. You get that? And like always, one of the clear reasons this was not resolved for such a long time is because people kept on using IE6. You gonna bash IE6? Okay. So, another example, like how you think it would happen. So let's say you think you're clicking someplace, and you know the user, what you can see is the mouse cursor, but what's actually happening. So this is where the real cursor is. Okay? This is where your mouse cursor is. This is the point where you have not clicked the button. Clicking this button is just to trigger an action and trigger an event. Sorry, you know, in JavaScript it's called an event, right? So trigger the event. This is what it is. This is some graphic. As soon as you click the button, this has reached where you have clicked, which you can easily find. But this is where your real and this is just some tweet something. These like those, you know, the tweet things with count of tweets you get. So this is called cursor jacking. Again, people have created these demo pages, so you know others like us can understand better what's happening. But the UI part is, you would think, obviously this person has made the cursor black to show you the difference. It doesn't have to be, it can be exactly like this. Right? So the person using the web page will not realize that there is anything wrong, you know, there's anything amiss. Did you get this example? I think it's not very clear, the image. So this is the real cursor, the fake cursor, and after you've clicked the button, what happens is the fake cursor reaches the button, because that's where your cursor was. You click there, but it actually reached here, and this is what happened. You see, it's a toggle button, yes, no. So next time you click, you'll tweet. But this is like a benign example. In reality, they could have done the tweet with the first click itself. Question. Someone asked a question?
No, I mean, this is very difficult. I mean, you need to trust the side, right? And it looks as if behind the scenes it can be like anything.
You, well, you trust so many things on the internet. First of all, you trust your ISP to give you a network which is wire-free. Then you trust your ISP to give you a DNS which is not poisoned, which means that if you want to go to your bank site, you're actually going to your bank site. Every time you put in, you know, you go to a website and you accept Google Analytics JavaScript, you're trusting Google, even though you're not on Google's website, you're trusting Google's this thing, that their JavaScript which is getting injected in your page is fine, right? And you're trusting obviously trusting the web server or the website you're on, then you trust them with your data. So that happens all the time. You trust the browser, which is a free piece of software. And if you read the usage terms or something, all the browsers come with clear this thing, that they are not liable if you break your computer. Right? So trust is a major issue. The thing is, that's a different discussion. The thing is, what can you do here? Okay. Now, if your job is to build web applications, or if your job is to design web applications, right? Now, obviously, security doesn't occur in isolation, which is why we have so many of these social engineering attacks. Because people they don't care, right? They don't realize it's wrong. They just want to use the computer and they want to trust everything. The point is, what can you do about this? Now, this is not only about clickjacking. The mitigations are for UI redressal attacks, right? Even though I gave you some examples of what clickjacking is doing, the mitigations are for UI redressal. Like, user interface gets changed. All the mitigations here still assume that your browser is trustworthy, right? Now, if you install an extension, if you install a toolbar, a browser helper object in your browser, that changes the UI, then there is nothing you can do. These mitigations will not work, right? These mitigations are only from the point of view that you, as the, you know, the person responsible for the website or whatever internet content is being consumed by your user, you can do something about it. Okay, they also come with their own caveats, but we'll discuss that. So the first thing is called frame bursting, and then I'm also going to talk about white fields. Frame bursting simply means, what is the big problem? You cannot blacklist the Z index. You cannot say don't render CSS. Your sites will not look so pretty. You know, I have a friend who's giving a talk on good design equal to good typography. Most of the typography that happens is JavaScript and CSS enables it. Right? So that's not an option. And if you're a designer, if I tell you that, you know, just keep it simple, keep it plain, then you're gonna just come and hit me. So what do? You target the iframe. You say my content, my website cannot be iframed. You think that's a feasible thing? You all agree? Plus one, minus one, zero. Okay. Well, it doesn't matter because it's been done. So. And then I'm going to talk about something called the X-frame header, which is not even at the level of your HTML. It's at the level of HTTP. It's part of a header that the server is going to send you. And if your browser supports it, if you have a modern enough browser, your browser will, you know, allow that to happen. Your browser will follow that directive. This is a common example of frame bursting, which simply means if this is, you know, if your website gets loaded in the iframe, it will check if top dot location is not equal to location, top dot location is equal to self dot location. Okay? How many of you understand the JavaScript here? Well, most of you, then you know more than I do about this. So I just know that this works. But I do know JavaScript is not a good example or, you know, not a good mitigation for anything because you don't control the JavaScript. Once it has gone to the browser, it's gone to the browser. If someone sitting in the middle removes, strips out the JavaScript, the user is still, you know, susceptible. So Stanford, there are a bunch of people in Stanford, they did some research and they looked at the top 500 websites in Alexa. Alexa is this website ranking and something thing, and they looked at the top 500 websites and they realized that only 3 websites were using this or the X-frame header option properly. 497 top 500 websites of Alexa, which means a lot of big websites, right? High traffic websites, which means so many users, they were not using it properly. So this is their recommendation. Okay, this is, there's a style, HTML, visibility, hidden, script, something. I don't know why there's an FNG, I'll fix this. There's a problem with that. If self equal to top, document element style visibility is visible. Else, top location is self location. If JavaScript is disabled in the browser, nothing will load. Okay, otherwise it will work and set it up. I don't know, Stanford guys are saying it, maybe I want to believe them, maybe I don't want to believe them. But if you want to, you try this, right? This is a frame bursting option. Now, even though if we have a header in HTTP level, why do we need to do this? Because people still use browsers which are old, right? There are so many installations of Firefox 3.6 or before. There are so many installations of IE6, maybe.
So this also means if people who have JavaScript disabled can't see
my network. If you are worried about this, it's breaking stuff, yeah. There are no easy options. But again, are you targeting the kind of people where your website will run for IE6 all the time? Yeah, I have not even done any research on that. It's like, let's not even go there. Let's just stick to the desktop browsers for now. Honestly, it'll be worse because now a lot of mobile browsers, including Safari, they started accepting and processing JavaScript. But I'm not really sure what they're doing with it. I would like to believe that they're at least keeping up with these headers. So if it's a new installer of mobile Safari or mobile Opera, by the way, Opera doesn't support that X-frame option. We have an Opera guy here, right? Somewhere. You should ask him. This is what X-frame options does. This is used to prevent clickjacking. First of all, it's meant for that. Okay, no prizes for guessing, but can you guess which company came up with this option? Google? Microsoft, yeah. For IE8. Internet Explorer 8 is, this is when they realized that they needed something for avoiding clickjacking. There are a couple of options that you can pass to it. One is deny, which is like don't render at all if inside a frame. one is same origin, which is like only if it's being same from the, served from the same domain, then serve it. And it is supported with IE 8 and above, Firefox 4 and above, Chrome 5 and above. I am not sure of you know, which version of Safari supports it. It supports it now, that much I know. Okay, what this will do, and I don't think it's visible, but I'm trying to load Gmail inside an iframe. It refuses to load. The image is showing that this content cannot be displayed in a frame. Only in IE, Internet Explorer, you will get this message. In Firefox and Chrome, it will just not show you anything, but it will not give you a message also. The simple reason is, as soon as you start showing this kind of a message, it's likely that someone will misuse it, because they'll add another link, click here for support, which will download some EXE or something. So Firefox and Chrome are likely not showing anything. Facebook doesn't load anything. Times of India gets loaded. And I haven't tried the other websites. You might want to have a look at that. I also have the same thing, I mean the HTML page is nothing but, you know, just the iframes. And Gmail, Facebook and Twitter don't load. Okay, because they are very clear, if X frame options is set, which has been sent by the server, if the browser supports it, we will not load inside a frame. So you might realize how difficult the situation was for these guys. It's a pretty drastic measure, right? That I'll not allow iframing on my website at all. Even though we tend to rely on iframes for a lot of things. Okay, that's all I have. This is me, my name is Akash Mahajan. You can send me a mail if you have any questions about this. There is a list of references after this slide, if you need that. I'll be uploading a slide on SlideShare, and you should also see JavaScript Online if you haven't. Maybe more ideas about attacks in JavaScript. Please give me a plus one if you liked it, zero if you didn't, or you're neutral, minus one if you don't like it. But please give feedback. Thanks a lot.